Welcome to this very last lecture of this short course on machine learning in communications. In this lecture, we are going to focus on a case study on distributed learning in wireless networks, where we'll also use some of the ideas that we introduced in lecture 7. This specific case study is going to focus on gradient compression for federated learning, which is a specific distributed learning technique as we'll learn shortly. And we'll also see what exactly is the wireless communication perspective in this problem. And this is joint work with my graduate students, Kirtan Abhogi and Chiranjeev Saha. So thanks to them for this kind of contribution. Before we go into any details, let's first quickly discuss why do we care about distributed learning in wireless networks, right? If you remember from our first 7 lectures, the sort of the setting we had was that you have this large data set, right, at one location, and you're also processing that data at that location, right? We never really put this out aloud, but that was the implicit assumption we made, and that is what we call the conventional ML setting, right? Or centralized machine learning setting. Now, if you think of the evolution in wireless networks, right, we have so many edge devices. Think of your smartphones, your tablets, your laptops, many different types of sensors being deployed as a part of IoT network. So all these devices are collectively called edge devices. They are producing so much data, right? So what we eventually get is this massively distributed data set in a wireless network. On top of that, there might be some privacy concerns where, for example, if I have some data on my phone, I may not be very comfortable sharing that data with the network, right? So we have privacy concerns and we have a massively distributed data set, right? Now, even if we ignore privacy, right, maybe there are applications where privacy is not that of a big of a concern, it is still very inefficient. And in some cases, it might be just impossible to transmit these small data sets from all the edge devices to some central server, right? Or say a base station for centralized machine learning, right? So clearly, decentralized learning is very well motivated in a wireless setting just because of how the data is generated, right? So in this talk, our focus is going to be on a very specific decentralized learning technique called federated learning, which has gained a lot of popularity recently. Okay. So let's quickly introduce what federated learning idea is. I will first give an overview and then we will go through some mathematical equations as well as to what exactly is happening here. Now, what federated learning tries to do is it circumvents the need for this transmission of these large data sets from your mobiles, which I'm also going to call as agents, to the server. Think of that as a base station, right? So without doing that, it allows for training a central model, right? A machine learning model, which is being trained at some central node, right? It is trained through this federated optimization where these local agents are going to do some computations on their local data set and then share some updates with the central server. And the central server is going to aggregate all those updates to update a central model, okay? And we'll see this in more detail. So one of the important things that I just introduced here is aggregation of the locally trained models. We'll see that there are multiple ways of aggregating, and we will aggregate in a specific way, which is also sort of aligned with the wireless setting that we'll consider. Okay. Now you might ask, right, how is federated learning different from any other distributed learning technique? So there are some unique features of federated learning that people often point out. People say that in federated learning setting, you may have these small data sets at different devices which are non-identically distributed, right? Think of two people, right? So the type of pictures they take, maybe one person is a nature lover. So most of the pictures you'll see in their phone will be of trees or mountains and so on, right? Think of another person who maybe likes downtown, those, you know, big cities, and the pictures in their phones might be of big buildings and so on, right? Although the data set is a sort of an image data set in that application, but the nature of the images are very different, right? So what we try to do here is we treat these small data sets as a part of a larger data set, and we are trying to learn the distribution or characteristics of this larger data set by using updates from these smaller data sets from all the agents, right? In federated learning, your data sets could be also unbalanced, massively distributed as we just discussed. And obviously there are these limited communication resources that come into the picture, right? If we are exchanging some information between the agents and the server, we just don't have infinite bandwidth. So we have to be very careful as to what we transmit. So this federated learning idea was proposed by Google. So this is one of the early references if you are interested in reading. And then we wrote a paper with one of my former postdocs, Dr. Solmaz Niknam, and one of my colleagues at Virginia Tech, Professor Reed, which appeared in Communications Magazine last year. So if you want to read about federated learning more from the wireless perspective, this could be a useful reference. Okay. So in order to understand, right, what is going on in federated learning, we need a very quick refresher of gradient descent and stochastic gradient descent, right? I know that most of you here know these ideas already, also based on the type of questions I have been getting. But let me just very quickly refresh so that we can put the federated learning idea a little bit more formally. Okay, so I'm going to introduce some notation here. So W are going to be my model weights or model parameters. We are going to, in this lecture, we are going to use neural networks. So you can think of these Ws as your neural network weights. D is the data set, right? And F is my choice of the loss function, right? So the cumulative loss over the complete data set is nothing but loss computed for a point U in my data set D, right? For this choice of weights W, and then you just sum that up over the complete data set, right? So this is my cumulative loss. Now the way I update these parameters is by finding the gradient of this cumulative loss, right? So this is my notation for the gradient. And so think of gradients as just a collection of partial derivatives, right? So this is nothing but if you take, for example, the gradient of this summation, you basically get just the summation of these gradients. So this form will be useful for a couple of our arguments. So once you know, right, the gradient, then the way you update your weights is WT plus one is nothing but WT minus some learning rate times the gradient. So you know in which direction to update your update your weights in, right? So that's the information that your gradient is giving. Now, first observation here is that if you are doing this one iteration of update, W going from time T to T plus one, we need to compute this gradient over the complete data set. Now, this can be extremely slow if your data set is massive. And this is a discussion we have already had in one of the live sessions. So one of the solutions that people use in order to overcome this limitation is the stochastic gradient descent algorithm, where instead of finding this cumulative loss over the complete data set, what you do is you pick up one element or one data point from your data set, and you compute your loss function only for that point, and then you update your model, right? So this is the gradient here. Notice that it is only for one point U belonging to the data set. This is the gradient GT, and you use this gradient GT here in your model update, right? So this is definitely a much, much faster technique for your model update. But of course, in this case, your loss function is going to have higher fluctuations because you're not really averaging your complete loss right over the data set, and hence higher variance as well. So one of the middle ways that one can take is to do something called a mini batch stochastic gradient descent, where you what you do is from your larger data set B, you select some of the data points randomly and call them this CalM. Right? This is your smaller, very small data set that you create. And then you compute your cumulative loss, right? Or your gradients, equivalently your gradients, using this smaller data set, right? So this is called mini batch SGD. Now, if your M, CalM, is equal to CalB, which is your complete data set, then stochastic gradient descent is nothing but gradient descent, right? The classical gradient descent. If the cardinality of M is one, meaning you just select one element or one data sample, then mini batch stochastic gradient descent is nothing but stochastic gradient descent, right? But people often, when they say stochastic gradient descent, sometimes they just refer to mini batch SGD. So there is mini batch SGD sometimes is just equated to SGD if you read some machine learning papers. Okay, so now with this in mind, right, keeping this stochastic gradient descent in mind, let's introduce federated learning, right? So keep in mind that federated learning can be implemented in multiple ways. And the way we are going to do it is to basically implement a distributed version of stochastic gradient descent, right? So there are four steps. Let's just go through those four steps one at a time. So we have a total of K users, right? Think of these as K mobile phones, for instance, right? And they are updating their local learning model. So they have their own data sets. So first of all, this should be B1, B2, so on up to BK. These are the local data sets with each of those devices, right? Now, using those local data sets, they are updating their local weights, which are going to be represented as WNT, W sub NT, where N represents the index for the user. And while updating those weights, they get these gradients, GNT. So GNT are the gradients obtained by the nth user using its own local data set, BN. Now these users will send these local gradients of the updated local model to the central server. So these GIs, right, let's just look at G2, for example. G2 is what is obtained at the user. And then this is sent, or some function of this gradient, think of a compression, because that's something we are going to do very soon, right? This G2 is uploaded to the server. Okay. Now, step three is that the server is going to aggregate. It is going to aggregate all these gradients from different users and use that aggregated gradient to update its global model. So this edge server is also keeping track of a global model. So it is going to update those weights. So by this model, you can think of just a neural network, right? Any architecture of the neural network, and its weights are being updated both at the clients and the server. It's exactly the same architecture. Okay. So at the edge server, you are going to get your current weights WT for what I'm going to call the global model. So that is the model that is being maintained at the edge server. And then these WT, the global weights, are fed back to the client. Okay? So this WT here, for example, WT is sent back to the client. And these global weights are then used by the clients to update their local weights. Right? Now they obtain, so they use these global weights, and then they again do gradient descent and again share their local local gradients to the edge server. Edge server will again aggregate and so on. Right? This is how the federated learning process works. So a quick summary, right? WN are the local weights, which are for the local models of the agents. GN were the gradients for the these local learners. And GT is the cumulative gradient that you get, the aggregated gradient that you get at the server. So here, what I wanted to highlight mainly is the fact that in order to obtain GT, which is my aggregated gradient, I don't actually need the individual GNs. What I need is just the sum of these gradients. And this will be very useful for our wireless application, okay? And note that this is the distributed SGD implementation of federated learning, right? This is just summation of these gradients. This appears in the distributed stochastic gradient descent, right? So just the takeaway then, as I said before, what we need is just the summation over the gradient. So keep that in mind because that is going to appear very soon. Okay, so let's start connecting this federated learning idea to wireless communication, okay? So what I'm going to assume here is the following, that I have a, say, a base station, right? And I have many devices. Say this is my X1 device, X2, so XN, right? So these devices are transmitting the symbols X1, X2, XN to the base station. And let's consider a Gaussian MAC channel. What that does is at the base station, my received signal is nothing but summation over all the signals transmitted by these K devices. Let me use uppercase K to be consistent. And then you have a noise term. And this is just the generalization of AWGN channel, right, to a max setting where you are getting the summation of signals from different devices, right? So that is given here. And I'm going to call this summation term summation over Xn as just Xt. If you want to read more about this connection of federated learning with wireless, then this paper that appeared in Transactions on Signal Processing last year would be a good reference. So this would be a good read for that. Okay. So where exactly in this setting are we going to focus, right? In this talk and in general, where exactly are we focusing in our work? So note that sending these gradients and weights back and forth, right, for after each iteration is going to require lots and lots of wireless resources. So extremely inefficient process, right? So one solution is to compress these gradients at the clients and then send those compressed versions to the servers where they are reconstructed again to have a reconstructed version of the gradient, okay? So this compression reconstruction aspect is going to be our focus. And we'll see that in contrast to what has already been done, our proposed will be aware of the properties of the gradients that are being compressed. And then there will be an interesting connection to expectation maximization, which we covered in lecture 7, okay? We'll see all that. Before that, let's introduce our notation because some of this might be appearing, some of this will be appearing in the later slides. So let FC be a gradient compressor, meaning if I have a gradient GN of T, right? If I give that as an input to FC, I get this signal XNT, which is then transmitted over the wireless channel, right? As we saw in the previous slide. So XNT is my compressed version of the gradient. Okay, so we are going to use a linear compressor. And by linear compressor, I mean that if XNT is FC of GNT, then using the notation from the previous slide, this also means that XT is FC of GT, right? Remember, GT is the summation over the gradients and XT is the summation over these compressed versions of the gradient. So we'll see that with this linear compression assumption, this Gaussian MAC model automatically provides the server with a noisy gradient sum without needing to transmit this each gradient separately. So you don't really need to assign separate resources for each transmission. Okay. And we are going to denote the reconstructed gradient at the central server as G hat of T. So this is our reconstruction of this total gradient. All right, So let's revisit the federated learning procedure just to again reinforce where exactly is our contribution going to be. So this is just a summary of the process that we have been following, right? On the devices, what we do is we compute the gradients based on the local data set using stochastic gradient descent. Then we are going to compress these gradients and come up with these transmit signals X and T. This step is of interest to us. What channel does is you get your received signal YT as just summation over the transmit signals from all the devices which are accessing the channel simultaneously, right? Plus some noise term, right? And X and T here, again, just to remind you, is just the compressed version of the gradients. And what your server or equivalently base station, right? I'm using those terms interchangeably here. What that is going to do is it's just going to compute this reconstructed version of your gradient. And this step is also of interest to us, right? Once you have this reconstructed version, then you simply just update your weights using this reconstructed version and then send those weights back to the agent. Okay. So let's set up the problem again, sort of summarizing what we discussed, but summarizing really the key points here. The objective for us is to recover this sum of gradients, right? From this summation that we are receiving, XT equals to summation of this, right? Or it's rather the noisy version because noise is also getting added to it, right? So we don't really need the point is we don't really need the individual gradients. We need to just estimate the summation and that is sufficient for this problem, right? Just because of how we are aggregating the gradients, that's our assumption. So we are going to define our compression ratio as the original length of the gradient N, right? Of each gradient, divided by the length of the compressed gradient, right? So this compression ratio is by definition bigger than or equal to one, right? So bigger the value, better it is. Now, in the rest of this talk, what I'm going to do is I'm going to present a technique that compresses and reconstructs these gradients efficiently. And we are going to use some of the key properties of the gradients that we see in neural networks, okay? So not surprisingly, this area of gradient compression is also of interest to machine learning community. You can actually find several papers on this from the machine learning community. There are two of these papers are quoted here in case you are interested. Of course, they are not considering the wireless setting, but there are also some papers considering this gradient compression problem in the wireless setting. And one of the papers was quoted on a previous slide. Okay, so to recap, we are going to do this compression and reconstruction, and our proposed technique is going to be cognizant of the properties of the gradient. So let's see what are those properties of the gradients that we are going to use. Okay, so first of all, whenever you use neural networks, the gradients that are generated during the training process of the neural network have two key properties. First of all, they are sparse, we'll discuss that. And there is also temporal correlation. So let's look at these two properties one at a time. So it has been observed empirically that the gradients of a neural network are extremely skewed in the sense that most of the values are actually close to zero. And I will show some evidence through a picture in a couple of slides. So what this means for us is that whenever we have this very frequent exchange of gradients, we can probably use this sparsity to our advantage, right? If only a few of these elements are going to be non-zero and the others are almost close to zero, then what we can do is we can actually use some type of a threshold technique to suppress the gradient values which are close to zero, right? To be absolutely equal to zero. This is called gradient sparsification. And then we can use the properties of these sparse signals to somehow compress these gradients, which is what we will be doing very shortly, right? So second property is temporal correlation. This is relatively easy to understand. So remember, what exactly is gradient descent doing? You have some smooth surface, right? Let's say this is the point where your weights are currently. This is your sort of loss function that you are traversing during the training process. So you compute a gradient at this step, right? And let's say your learning rate is such that you reach this step, right? In the next update, in the next iteration, you are again going to compute a gradient at this step, and then you're going to do an update. Because of the smooth underlying loss function, you see that the gradients you computed here at this step and this step are highly correlated, right? So this is the reason you often get temporal correlation if you have reasonable learning rates in this problem, okay? So we are done with two properties. We are going to use one of these, as we'll see. And then whenever you have data sets in which there are some spatial features to learn, think of images, right? There are some spatial features to learn, then we often use convolutional neural networks, which have this, so gradients for the convolutional layers have this additional property of spatial correlation, okay? So they exhibit sparsity and temporal correlation, but they also have some type of spatial correlation. I will show this in the next slide, what I mean by spatial correlation, but before that, let me try to give some intuition as to why we get this spatial correlation. So as some of you, again, if you haven't seen convolutional neural networks before, you can just think of this as an abstract idea that we are getting spatial correlation and then how to capture this in the learning process, right? So you can focus on that part. If you have seen convolutional neural networks before, let me in just 1 minute explain from where this spatial correlation is coming, right? In convolutional layers, what we are actually doing is we are using, in this picture, for instance, we are using F convolutional filters, right? So these, I won't be really saying much about these convolutional filters because just to stay on the topic here, but you can just think of these filters as being convolved over your input data, right? And the weights of these filters are what we will be learning in the process, right? And then we will be computing gradients with respect to those weights. So if you now just visualize the convolution operation, right? So two weights, which are in each other's neighborhood, say here, corresponding to this filter, right? The gradients that appear corresponding to these weights will have the common input data terms, right? If you write the gradients for these weights, you'll see that there are some common terms corresponding to the input data. And because of the presence of those common terms, these gradients are going to be correlated. And this is what we call spatial correlation, where gradients which lie in each other's neighborhood exhibit some type of correlation, okay? So for this picture, right, if you have this 3D filter where you have the dimensions of the filter are H cross D cross W, and you have F such filters, if you write the gradients corresponding to these F filters, you actually get a 4D tensor, which is H cross W cross D cross F, right? Again, it's not very important to go into the exact details of, you know, why tensor, why 3D and so on, right? I mean, that's sort of immaterial for what we are going to study, but in order to give you a visual representation of what this spatial correlation means, let me represent this 4D tensor as a 2D matrix, okay? And as we, for example, if we vectorize a matrix, right? Let me just explain this one point before we go to the picture. Let's say I have a matrix A1, A2, A3, A4, right? 2x2 matrix. Now these elements A2 and A3 are in the neighborhood of A1. Let's just define that a neighborhood, just the adjacent values, right? In a tensor, it will be a lot more complicated, but you'll see the idea of what I want to convey. Now, let's say I vectorize this matrix. I write this as A1, A3, A2, A4. Right. Notice that A2 was in the neighborhood of A1 in your matrix representation, but that information is lost here in your vector representation, right? So when we go from a 4D tensor to a 2D matrix, we are not going to be able to capture this neighborhood information that a tensor is going to contain, right? You can sort of visualize what is going on here. Okay. So that being said, My matrix that I'm going to consider is this matrix G, which is HW cross FD real matrix, okay? So if I consider now a convolutional layer with dimensions 5, 5, 10, 20, right? You can see that in the previous slide if you wish to, but again, these exact numbers are not very important. The matrix that you get is 25 cross 200. So this is 25, this is 25, and this dimension here is 200. Right, so each element, each pixel in this image, sort of you can think of that as corresponding to one entry in your matrix. Okay, so if I look at first row here, that corresponds to a specific value of HW, right? And then you are scanning over all other values of FD. If I look at the second column here, that corresponds to a neighboring value of HW, and then you are again traversing through all possible values of FD, like scanning through the values of FD. You see that these rows are highly correlated, meaning if you see a red pixel here, right? Let me use another color. If you see a red pixel here, a bright pixel or a white pixel here, you are seeing those similar white pixels here as well. So this is what I meant by spatial correlation. Okay? Now, if you using this image, if you compute the correlation matrix, which will be a 25 plus 25 matrix, you actually see that correlation even more clearly, right? So these are going to be bright values, obviously, but you see that the neighboring values are also high. So there is this high correlation. Now you're also getting some sort of recurrent pattern here, right? There is a recurrent pattern here. And that is because your neighborhood structure was disturbed when you flattened the tensor into a matrix. Okay, so these actually correspond to the neighboring elements in a tensor, but they are being shown as far away elements in a matrix. Okay, again, all those details are not really necessary. The point was to just show that we have this spatial correlation, which we can exploit in a specific way. All right, so now our objective, right, is to exploit these properties that we have learned, right? We are going to jointly exploit the sparsity of the gradients and the spatial correlation in the gradients of the convolutional layer, right? Remember that the spatial correlation is specific to the convolutional layers, but if your data set is something like an image data set, then obviously you're going to likely have multiple convolutional layers, right? And I didn't remark this before, we can discuss this offline or during the live session, but in a lot of these learning architectures, like even standard architectures like, you know, ResNet or LXNet and so on, you could have tens of thousands and even, you know, up to millions of parameters that you are trying to learn, right? So even if you can or if you can compress by a factor of two or so, that's a significant saving, okay? All right, so since we have sparsity, compressive sensing is naturally going to come into the picture. If you haven't gone through compressive sensing or you don't work on compressive sensing, let me just go through sort of two bullet points here just to give you the context of where exactly compressive sensing is going to be used here. So compressive sensing is a technique to reconstruct signals by finding solutions to underdetermined linear systems when your signals are sparse, right? So this is based on the principle that if you have sparsity in the signal, that can be exploited to recover it from samples that are sampled at a much lower rate than the Nyquist rate. So you don't really need to sample that signal at the Nyquist rate to recover that efficiently, okay? Again, this recovery oftentimes is approximate recovery, right? Okay, So just to introduce some notation, which is very similar to the notation we have used before, let S be a sparse signal, right? Which for us is what? It's just the gradients or some of the gradients, depending upon what you're looking at. And this signal, sparse signal, right? We say that it is measured through a matrix A, right? Whose dimensions are D cross N, using this noisy measurement model. Y dash is A, S plus N, right? So you can think of this matrix A as your compressor, right? Now, if D is smaller than N, you can think about it. If D is smaller than N, you have an underdetermined system, meaning you have less equations, right, than the number of parameters you have. But the point is, if S is sparse, you can, using compressive sensing ideas, you can reconstruct it even from this underdetermined linear system. So now you can think of S as your original signal, and you can think of Y as your compressed version of that signal. Okay. And in our setting, we are going to assume that this compressor A, right, is known to all the agents and also to the server. Okay. Now, let's introduce this N0 here, N sub O. NO is the number of non-zero entries we have in S. So NO is, you can say that it's sort of a measure of sparsity. So using NO, you can define the sparse ratio as NO divided by N, right? So smaller this ratio, more sparse of a signal you have. Now, the goal of sparse signal reconstruction, which is what we are going to study, is to recover S from its compressed version Y and this compressor A, okay? So if you want to read more about compressive sensing, there is tons of literature on that. There are books, one of them, the edited book I'm quoting here from 2012, there are so many tutorials on this topic. So you can easily find something off your taste on this topic if you want to learn these ideas. Okay, but let's move on. And now what I'm going to do is I'm going to try and model these convolutional gradients, right? So remember my setting that I introduced in the previous slide is nothing but Y equals to AS plus N, right? So now I can write the likelihood of Y, right, given S. Y given S is nothing but Gaussian because N was modeled to be Gaussian in our setting. So you can write this likelihood as nothing but a Gaussian PDF, right? So these are the type of expressions which we have extensively used in the previous lectures. Now let's see how we are going to model sparsity, okay? So in order to model the sparsity of the gradients, I am going to use a type of so-called spike and slab prior. And I'm going to put that prior on my sparse signal S. So this spike and slab prior is just a sparsity promoting prior. Let me just go through this carefully with you, what exactly it is doing. So P of S is my prior on S, right? I assume that each of these elements in S, in this signal S are independent and also identically distributed. So I get this product, I equals to 1 to N, N was the number of elements in S, and P of Si now is the distribution for ith element, right? And I model this basically as a mixed distribution, or you can think of this as a mixture of a delta and another distribution H. Let's first understand this form, right? What exactly are we getting by this linear combination? And then I will describe what H is. So here, if you think about this delta function, what this is really doing is it is putting a point mass at zero, right? So you can then interpret 1 minus lambda I as the probability you're putting on Si to take a value zero, right? Or Si will be, according to your prior, will be zero with a probability 1 minus lambda I, and it will be non-zero with probability lambda I. And HSI is the distribution you choose for the non-zero entries. And we are going to model HSI just Gaussian, and with parameters with say mean theta and variance phi. And so these become our model parameters, theta and phi, right? And another of the parameters we have here is sigma squared. Yet another parameter or set of parameters I have are lambda I, right? These are all the parameters I'm introducing in the prior. All right. Okay, so I'm going to introduce this vector notation lambda, which are all the lambda I's, right, from I equals to 1 to n that appear in my spike and slab prior. All right. So then I'm going to write my set of parameters, that set of parameters that appear in my prior as this vector Q. Right? Lambda is what we just discussed. Theta phi are the parameters of my Gaussian, right? H of SI, and sigma square is the parameter that appeared in my likelihood. Okay. Now, so this becomes your model, right? This is where I'm going to connect with something we discussed in lecture 7. So now we propose this sparse signal reconstruction problem as the minimum mean square estimation problem, MMSE estimation problem of S. Okay. So this is my MMSE estimate of the sparse signal, right? And that is nothing but argmin over minimum mean square, right? So mean squared error. So this is the squared error loss expectation over that, which we have been using pretty much from the first lecture. I never really called it MMSE because I didn't really want to give that flavor right away, but that was really MMSE. And the MMSE estimate that you get here, as we saw in the very first lecture, we called it a regressor as well, right? So this is nothing but your posterior mean. So we know what the MMSE estimate is under your model choice Q. So you need to know those parameters Q, right? Now, just to recap, how did we introduce sparsity in our model, right? Through a choice of a prior that is sparsity inducing, okay? How are we going to introduce spatial correlation? This is something I'm not going to go through in detail. Our paper on this topic will be up on archive in about a month or so. So we are going to describe this in a lot of detail there. We don't have the time to go through this in more detail, but the general idea is when you update these lambda i's, we are going to use some kind of local averaging during the update process to update these parameters, which is going to induce spatial correlation as well, right? And there is a mathematical reason for why this local averaging makes sense, which we will describe in the paper. But for now, just keep in mind that, okay, we introduced a prior, right? It had some parameters lambda I. The sparsity was introduced by the choice of this prior form, and a spatial correlation is introduced by the way we are updating these prior parameters. Okay, that's pretty much it in order to understand the rest of the lecture. Okay. Now, in the federated learning setting, the sparse signal is really nothing but the sparsified gradient sum, right? So there is, as I've been sort of making this one-to-one connection pretty much over the last few slides, right? So the sparse signal is nothing but our gradients. Now, our approach here is going to use, it sort of combines two very powerful inference frameworks. One is the expectation maximization, which you guys know very well by now. And the second is a classical compressive sensing reconstruction algorithm from the class of approximate message passing. Okay, so let me at a very high level tell you what exactly is going on here. So expectation maximization is going to give me an estimate of Q, my parameters. You know that, I mean, these parameters, you can think of these as latent variables now, right? Because they don't really explicitly appear. These are your model parameters. You can estimate that using expectation maximization, right? Iterating between the E step and the M step as we discussed in lecture 7. Now, using this estimate of Q, using AMP, you can come up with the estimate of your sparse signal S, which will be a function of Q, right? Whatever model parameters you use. Now, using this, you can feed this back to the EM block, and you can update your queue. Then you send that updated queue back to AMP, and you find your updated reconstructed signal. And then you just keep on iterating between the expectation maximization and the AMP algorithm. And that gives you your reconstructed signal. Okay? So let's now look at some preliminary results. As I said, this is our ongoing work. I won't be having very extensive set of results, but let me show you some preliminary results just to convince you that if you introduce some domain knowledge, which in our case was the properties of the gradients, it does help us. Right? The benchmark technique with which we'll be comparing our solution is that transactions on signal processing paper that I quoted before, which just uses the basic compressive sensing reconstruction technique. It doesn't really take into account the spatial correlation property, for instance, that we had in the convolutional layer. So we are going to incorporate all that in the proposed algorithm, right? So the setting that I'm going to show you is a simple federated learning setting with only one user, right? With a sparsity ratio of 0.25, which means that 75% of your gradients are zero, and a compression ratio of 2. Right, which means you are compressing, say if you have a vector of length 10, your compressed version is of length 5, right? So 50% saving there. Your learning rate is 0.1. This is a bit on the higher side, as we'll see also from the results. We haven't tested this on tons of convolutional neural networks, but we chose one reasonable architecture with three layers with the dimensions given here, not too important for this discussion. And we are using the standard MNIST dataset. You can read about it if you are interested. This is just the dataset of handwritten, so images of handwritten numbers, basically. Okay? And we will use our learned sort of model that we are learning through federated learning for this classification problem. We are going to use MNIST dataset and see if we can classify the handwritten number correctly or not. Okay, that is the task. Okay, so this is our result. On the y-axis, we have accuracy, right? If it is not clear, let me write this down. This is 0.8, 0.6, 0.4, 0.2. On the x-axis, we have iterations. This is iteration 50, 150, 250, 350, right? So one iteration here means that you do you learn a local model, you send it to the base station, it sends you back the global weights, right? That's one iteration. So what we do is after every iteration, right, we test the accuracy of our model on that standard data set, which is a classification problem, and we see how well we are doing. And we notice here the blue plot is our proposed method. And black plot is the benchmark. And the reason you are seeing these sort of wiggly behavior here is because of a slightly higher learning rate, right? If the learning rate is very small, then you will, of course, get a more sort of a bit more smoother plot here. Okay. So we notice that our algorithm, the proposed algorithm, because it is using some reasonable prior information, is converging significantly faster than the proposed algorithm, right? And this saving in this specific application could be significant, right? Especially if you go into some type of latency sensitive applications and so on, right? So the advantage we get if you use some carefully constructed priors is faster convergence in this specific case, okay? So with that, we are ready to conclude this last lecture of the course where we focused on a case study on distributed learning. And we saw that distributed learning idea is of specific interest to wireless networks, just how these massively distributed data sets are generated on the wireless devices, right, on the edge devices. So in this case study, we focused on the problem of gradient compression and reconstruction. So our specific contribution in this work is to incorporate the jointly incorporate sparsity and spatial correlation properties of the gradients by choosing an appropriate prior and then coming up. So then basically using EM in conjunction to AMP. So you need EM here because you are introducing this prior and you need to learn the parameters of this prior, okay? I wanted to stress on the EM part since we actually covered that in lecture 7. So I hope that you found this connection interesting. So we covered the theory behind EM in the previous lecture and also showed in what context could it actually be used in real applications, okay? This is, now connecting to our module 3 where we discussed theory-guided machine learning. You can think of this as another example of how appropriate domain knowledge, right, could be used. In this case, the domain knowledge came from the properties of the gradients, but it could be exploited to develop more efficient learning solutions, right? So these are the references that I quoted at different times of the presentation. Some of the more important ones were also quoted on the slides themselves. This is the second slide on the references. If you are watching this later, you can, of course, just freeze the slide and check these papers out if you're interested. So last but not the least, thank you so much for your attention, for the questions. So my email address is here. In case you have any additional questions, comments, or suggestions about not just this lecture, but the whole course, before I conclude, let me thank the organizers once again for organizing this very interesting event and for their very kind invitation to speak here. All right. Thank you very much, and I'll see you in the live session this evening.